thanks everyone. It's just felt really good just to share that. Yeah.
No, thank you. Well, that was lovely. Moving on. Rachel, hi.
Hi.
Are you happy to share something with us?
Yeah, sure. Like Laura, I can think of a speech, so you gave me a speech to look at. I think you said it was from Richard III. And I haven't had a chance to look at it, so...
Well, there's no pressure. Just take your time.
But I that am not shaped for sportive tricks, nor made to court an amorous looking glass, I that am rudely stamped and want love's majesty to strut before a wanton ambling nymph, I that am curtailed of this fair proportion, cheated of feature by dissembling nature, deformed, unfinished, why is he saying that he's deformed?
Well, I didn't, the character is explaining how they feel in a society that labels them as deformed.
So Rachel, in the speech, in the context of the speech, Richard's saying, everyone thinks that I'm a monster, everyone thinks that I'm deformed and horrible, so I'm going to become a monster and kill everyone, basically. And this is, he sort of sets that up in the speech.
That's right, that's it, yeah.
So why do people think he's deformed?
Well, he's got a humpback, he's handicapped, like.
Sorry, could you not use that word, please, Vince?
Sorry, which one, handicapped or?
Well, both, I suppose.
Okay, but... yeah, no, sorry, my bad. Yeah, sorry about that.
Yeah. And in actual fact, now I know that it's the real Richard III that Shakespeare's talking about, yeah? Yeah, I went to see the skeleton of when Richard III was found, and his scoliosis wasn't really visible, so he wasn't actually a hunchback at all. They could have disguised it with clothes, so.
All right, okay.
Well, do you have some thoughts about that, Rachel?
No, it's fine. Can I go again? I better go again.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
But I that am not shaped for sportive tricks, nor made to court an amorous looking glass, I that am rudely stamped and want love's majesty to strut before a wanton ambling nymph, I that am curtailed of this fair proportion, cheated of feature by dissembling nature, deformed, unfinished, sent before my time into this breathing world scarce half made up, and that so lamely and unfashionable that dogs bark at me as I hold by them. I'm sorry, I can't.
Is something wrong, Rachel?
Well, it's just because, like, I don't see myself as deformed, so I was just wondering why would you have given this speech to me?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I just made a snap decision on what speeches I thought people might have an easy connection with.
I see something.
Yes.
Why do you have to cap a disabled role to a disabled person? I mean, deformed is an ugly word.
That's a great question. To be honest, this is my first time using Shakespeare speeches as a tool for drama therapy, though you all know that I'm not a trained, qualified therapist.
Or a drama therapist. This is only a peer support group.
I just thought because there are different experiences with Shakespeare in this group that it
would help if I gave suggestions. But I apologize, Rachel, if I've caused any offense. I didn't really...
Melvin, can I just cut in and say, look, not everyone here is criticizing you, don't worry. I unlike when I chose a different speech, I wasn't criticizing you. Just want to point out, you know, I know Rachel is criticizing.
I wasn't criticizing. I just wanted to understand.
Oh, okay, cool. Whatever you happen.
Rachel, if I may, look, there's a great film by Al Pacino called Looking for Richard. If you can get your hands on it, it's kind of like a half documentary, half film of him playing Richard III, and it's brilliant for laying the politics bare so you can really understand everything that goes on in the play, because Richard III can be really quite complicated. There's lots of stuff that you you need to know before the play starts, and he explains that really well. But I think the thing that I find relevant to you is that I don't think that Richard thinks he's disabled either. But anyway, look, if you get the chance to check it out, then do, because it's brilliant. And Al Pacino's great in it. Yeah, that's all.
Okay, maybe I'll find a connection if I investigate more. I mean, that's what frustrates me, like being labelled disabled and then everyone treats you differently. It's my choice when and where I want to play the identity card. So, I'm sick of it. But, I might look at some other speeches as well.
Yeah. If you need any help looking for speeches, I actually know quite a lot, so I can point you in the right direction for some.
I might have a look at on my own.
It's fine. I was just, giving the offer in case you wanted it.
Thanks, but no.
Okay.
Rachel, I actually agree with you.
I don't want to be defined by my, as you say, identity cards either.
I mean, for years, I would always say, don't see me as just another black man. I'm a human first who identifies as a man, that because of how our species adapted to the sunlight happens to be more melanated than you. But for some people, they're proud to be labelled by their identity cards, and also a lot of people's cards are visible, so they don't have a choice. So for example, when someone's pretending not to see my colour, well, they're choosing not to see me.
I completely understand that, Melvin. You see, I have a kind of a different way around everyone, because my problem is that no one can see my disability. Even though I would like them to, it's just a part of who I am. And people might think that I'm just miserable or depressed for no reason, but it's not. It's like the invisible wound, we call it in the service. And it can hit you at any time, and it can last for weeks, or it can just hit you at any point during the day. I try my hardest not to let it affect me around my kids, because I don't want them to be okay. I'm gonna go. I'll be back.
That's okay. That's fine.
This is a safe space, and if that's how he feels to leave, then that's fine.
Sorry, I feel like that was my fault. I'm sorry.
No. It's I'm sure you. It's not your fault.
Who would like to see my art?
Sure.
I'm just going to show you how I made the print. So first of all, we discuss the ideas. So I'm doing the theme of bees because I love bees. Although that doesn't look like a bee. It looks like, I don't know, a fly with one eye. And then we just sketch it out. then reduce this to carve this out. And that becomes a B.
Let's keep eyeball this. And then you have to get like a line, though. Okay. I think you've got a B on this. They put ink in there, and then you have to roll it, and you have to make sure it's very dense, so it doesn't sink into the grooves. And then you have to press it, and you start to press, like, you have to really wrap it out, otherwise it won't come off. It won't. The ink at all, so you have to really pressure them. But when you peel it off, I really love how it feels like. I don't know how to explain it. It's like, I don't know how to explain it. So,
wow,
it wasn't very good. And then this one's the best one. This one is the best attempt. It took me a few tries. This is my best attempt, but it's got so much better.
That's brilliant.
Yeah.
Very
Vince.
Okay, sorry about that, everyone.
Oh, no worries at all, Vince. No worries at all. This is a safe space, so so
thank you.
You do whatever you feel is right. So, well, thank you, Dax. I'm really jealous, by the way. I can't wait to see some more. So thank you for that. Okay, well, I think that is it for our second session. Thank you all for being so open and sharing your speeches today. Like I said, hopefully next week we'll do something else. But just before we finish, I just wanted to ask Beryl, how did you find today's session? And also just a huge thank you again for stepping in at the last minute.
I was fascinated because Shakespeare, I don't really get. But, you know, watching you all, hearing you do all your speeches really had an impact on me, specifically the one who did Juliet. Laura, is it your name?
Yeah, that's my name.
Laura, hi. Yeah, I was really moved by your speech from Romeo and Juliet.
Thanks, Beryl.
I'm in bereavement. I had a daughter and she died. Lisa, her name is. Just a part of that speech really moved me. And I don't know if I can sign it, but it's the last bit if people want to read it.
Well, Beryl, if you don't mind, I know I'm throwing you in there, but please read the section you connected with for us, if you don't mind. The floor is yours.
Oh, well, it goes from come under gentle night towards the end of the speech. Come gentle night, come loving black-browed night. Give me my Lisa, and when she shall die, take her. I cut her out into little stars. And she will make the face of heaven so fine that all the world will be in love with night and pay no worship to the garish sun. Oh, I have bought the mansion of a love, but not possessed it. And though I am sold, not yet enjoyed. So tedious is the day, as is the night before some festival to an impatient child that hath new robes and may not wear them. It just reminded me of my little girl, and I just thought, no worries, I'm just, sorry.
That was really beautiful, Beryl.
Great stuff there, Beryl. Great stuff.
Well, I just wanted to say that you didn't need to sing for me. I could understand everything you were saying, the new emotion.
Thank you all. That's very kind of you.